Global expertise from San Fran to China. We're coal consultants, not your average miner. DSC and DAB are now confined to the house. And so now we bring you coal from the couch.
Hello, I'm Lara Smith. I'm here with Robin Goad from Fortune Minerals. How are you, Robin?
I'm well, thanks, Lara. Thanks for having me on.
Great. And where are you joining us from today?
So we're I'm with you today from London, Ontario, which is about halfway between Detroit and Toronto in southwestern Ontario in Canada.
Okay. And you're developing a critical metals project in the Northwest Territories in Canada.
That's correct. Our NICO project is, and its nearby satellite deposit, Sioux Diane, are both IOCGs. The mineral reserves for the NICO project are 33 million tons, containing one of the largest undeveloped deposits of cobalt outside of the DRC, which also contains more than 1 million ounces of gold and 12% of the global reserves of bismuth, which both bismuth and cobalt are considered critical minerals. They're both identified on the U.S. critical minerals list as well as the European Union's list.
Yes, that's correct. And so you're one of the largest reserves of cobalt in the Northern Hemisphere outside of the DRC. Is that correct?
Yes. It is a polymetallic deposit, so it sources its metals from four different recoverable metals, in addition to the cobalt and the gold and the bismuth. There's also copper. I think more importantly, it's a primary cobalt project, meaning that cobalt is the dominant metal or the dominant revenue source in the project, and it's one of the most advanced projects outside of the DRC. With $130 million expended to date, positive feasibility study, the environmental assessment approval to build the mine and the concentrator, and we're now just working with various potential partners on some process options, and hope to be able to construct this project over the next couple of years.
Okay, one thing that always interests me when you have a polymetallic project, and I suppose that's just because I come from an analyst background. If you're developing, so you've got four metals, if you will, cobalt being the primary one, how many of those need to be processed in order to be NPV positive?
All of them. We evaluate our project on a net smelter return basis.
Right.
So each metal contributes differently within the deposit. There's a zonation in the deposit where we have, for example, a gold-rich high-grade core that's in excess of 2 grams of gold per ton. So we have overlapping envelopes of gold. The cobalt is pretty much pervasive in the deposit, and the bismuth is also a little bit broader than the gold, but less pervasive than the cobalt. And the gold, and the copper really is a relatively insignificant byproduct. Generally speaking, today's prices were actually, if we used, today's $1,700 US gold and $17 cobalt, we'd actually derive most of our revenues from gold. But we don't expect the cobalt price to remain down here at that price level. We expect once COVID-19 is resolved and we get back to more normal economic conditions, then we'll be returning to greater demand for particularly battery metals.
Maybe that's just an interesting point, because cobalt, battery metals as a whole have come off largely from their highs, and cobalt in particular has been extremely volatile and it has come off completely. Where do you see the long-term cobalt price? I know it's a difficult question.
Yeah, it is. It really depends on your perspective, but generally speaking, the long-term 25-year average for cobalt is around $25 US per pound. Today, it's trading a little lower than that, and a year ago, it was as high as $48 per pound, so it is indeed a very volatile metal. that's one of the nice things about having over 1 million ounces of gold in the deposit. So you've got different sources of metal that you can rely on when you do have metal price volatility, particularly precious metals, which are countercyclical.
Yeah.
But getting back to your original question is where do we expect the price to be? If we look at most analysts' views of the current supply of cobalt and the prospective deposits that could come online, in about 2 years' time, we will be will deplete all of the known production opportunities for cobalt, and we're going to need additional cobalt mineralization or new deposits being identified. So today, I mean, you've actually got production coming offline in the DRC. Glencore, which is the largest corporate producer of cobalt, has shut down Mutanda and cut back a little bit at Katanga as well. But you've also got the consumption of cobalt down from slower industrial activity. So I expect in the next couple of years that we will be transitioning into a prolonged period of deficit, and that will be very very attractive for our project.
Right, and then bismuth. Bismuth is one of those lesser known critical metals, and from a market perspective, maybe you can just speak about a little bit about the market for bismuth. What is the price point, and who's buying it?
Yeah, that's complex as well, because it's a market that has about 20,000 tons of annual consumption. Very difficult to get reliable information. Its primary use is in the automotive sector. It's used for windshield frits. Those are the little black compound around the perimeter of the windshield of your car, which is protecting the windshield seal from degradation, from UV radiation, as well as changing temperatures, because bismuth is one of the very few metals which expands when it cools. So if you want to produce a dimensionally stable alloy or compound, you blend it in. It's used also in the automotive industry for anti-corrosion coatings, particularly German cars are electroplated in a bath with bismuth that is similar to a galvanizing process, but bismuth is actually replaces the lead because of toxicity concerns. I would say the greatest growth opportunity for bismuth is as a non-toxic, environmentally safe replacement for lead in free machining steels, in ceramic glazes and solders used in plumbing and electronics industries. And cosmetics, for example, is also utilizes bismuth. Castings, it's got quite a number of different applications. In terms of price, we're coming off a bit of a difficult period for bismuth because about 75% of production is coming out of China. And since we also had a large inventory of minor metals, not just for bismuth, but other minor metals, which were in something called the Fannie Exchange, which was a Ponzi scheme, which went bankrupt, I think, in 2015. But those inventories were purchased at the end of last year. And during that period, one of the major Chinese producers went bankrupt. A large producer in Vietnam stopped producing. So we're seeing the market transition back into balance. And generally speaking, the cost of production is around somewhere between $4 and $5 per pound. So I would expect that we'll see a price north of $5 per pound as this inventory is basically reduced.
Okay. And then what's next for Fortune Minerals? What are the next steps?
Yeah, we've just come through an interesting period. We have a positive feasibility study, and we had a project financing which was with a Chinese company a few years ago. That transaction didn't proceed, and we were in 2018 looking at very high cobalt prices. strategic partnerships in the automotive and battery industry. We're looking for larger production, so we expanded the project in an updated feasibility study, which was not the thing to do, because a lot of these metals that are vertically integrated projects, you really have to look at them from the perspective of processing as opposed to mining. They're really a processing plant with a captive source of material. So we've our original feasibility study at 4,650 tons per day was about right. We had a combination of underground and open pit mining, and we're going back to that philosophy where we had a very attractive rate of return. So we're going back to essentially the 4,650 ton per day project, combined underground and open pit mining. And we're also looking at collaboration on processing plants to reduce refinery capital costs. At the same time, we're in discussions with both the U.S. government as well as the Canadian government on critical mineral supply. This has become a very topical consideration, because not only because the risks that are associated with geographic concentration, for example, 70% of cobalt supply coming out of the DRC and 80% of the cobalt chemicals being produced in China has put U.S. and North American and also European industry at a disadvantage. So governments are looking to try and put some balance back into the markets. And even in this pandemic, it's also exposed how critical our supply lines are to have normal local sources of raw materials to support our businesses.
Yes, absolutely. And then has the American DOD and the Department of Defense and various departments of security, have they stepped forward? Have they? I know there's a lot of talk. I know there's a lot of interest, but have they actually stepped forward and become development partners?
They have made investments in a rare earth element project, which has already been announced. I can tell you that we have discussions with both the U.S. and the Canadian governments. I'm not at liberty to discuss those discussions at this point.
Yeah.
Other than we have proposals that are being looked at.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Is there anything else you'd like to add before we go?
Just highlighting the fact that we do have 1 million ounces of gold, and it can be mined or concentrate our mining in the gold-rich parts of the deposit, which exceeds 2 grams of gold per ton, 1 million ounces. So that's in itself, most people would consider a 2 gram deposit in an open pit mine to be economically attractive. And quite frankly, under normal metal price scenarios, it represents only about a third of the metal inventory in our mine. So we've got an attractive project with four different payable metals, three in particular. But also, being an IOCG, we're looking at exploration opportunities. We do have a satellite deposit. Large IOCGs in other parts of the world, like Olympic Dam, is 8.3 billion tons. They occur in clusters, with multiple deposits, sometimes in excess of 1 billion tons. Other examples of that deposit style are the Carajás deposits in Brazil, the Candelaria deposits in Chile. So we expect, we have some large geophysical anomalies that have not been tested. So in addition to the known deposit of 33 million tons, we have a satellite deposit plus some exploration opportunities, which we're looking at as well. And if it becomes a sort of a typical IOC district, there's huge exploration upside of this project.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, and best of luck with developing your project.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Robin. Take care.
Bye-bye.